Good morning.
Good morning.
As you see, we have a special altar today for Shakyamuni. In East Asian Buddhist country, that means Buddhist countries are influenced by Chinese tradition. We celebrate Buddha's birthday on April 8th. Today we have a celebration for Shakyamuni Buddha's birthday. It is said Shakyamuni was born in a park, not in the palace. It is said, you know, Buddha's mother wanted to go to her own home and the home of her parents. That was a kind of a custom in Asia. But on her way to go back to her own home, Buddha was born in the park. The Buddha's biography said there are many flowers on the park. And when Buddha was born, somehow the heavenly being, maybe Indra or Brahma, made a pond in the park. And two dragon kings pour the water. One dragon gave cold water, cool water, and another one pour the warm water, so it's like a shower, to bathe the baby Buddha. And it said the baby Buddha, right after he was born, stood up and walked seven steps to each direction. Each direction is east, west, north and south, and up and down. And he pointed the heaven and earth. That is what the baby Buddha is doing. And he said, above the heaven and on the earth, I'm the greatest. The baby said so. that is what this decoration means. Where Buddha was born, there are full of flowers. That is why we put so many flowers on the altar. And this time of the year in Japan was really beautiful time of the year. There are so many flowers. Probably still they have cherry blossoms and dandelions on the field and violet, all that kind of flowers. So collecting flowers are the job for children in the village temple. You know, children go to the field and collect the flowers and then decorate the shrine. And so this Buddha's birthday celebration is called Hana Matsuri. Hana is flowers and Matsuri is festival. So this is not only celebration for Shakyamuni's birth, but it's a celebration for new spring. And right after, you know, this season, you know, the farmers need to start to work, and they need to work hard. So this is a kind of a last time for those farmers to have a good time and enjoy the day. So it's a very important, precious kind of an annual event in Japanese culture. Today I'd like to introduce one Dharma discourse Dogen gave on the occasion of Buddha's birthday celebration. So at Dogen's time or at Dogen monastery, they celebrate the same occasion. And this Dharma discourse is given in 1241. As you know, Dogen was born in 1200, so he was 41 years old. They had Buddha's birthday celebration each year, of course, and Dogen gave the discourse, the speech on that occasion. And nine of that kind of that Dogen's discourses are recorded in Eihei Kolok, or in English, Dogen's extensive record. And this is the first one recorded in Eihei Kolok. And to me, this is interesting because in May, soon we'll have Genzoe, and this year, because this is the 15th anniversary of Sanshinji. So we have a kind of a special Genzoe, that means I usually give two lectures a day for 5 days, so I give nine lectures. But this time we invite two more teachers. One is Taigen Dan Layton from Chicago. He was the co-translator of Dogen's extensive record. And another teacher is Byakuren Legia. She is a former, what's her title?
Head teacher.
A former head teacher of Clouds in Water Zen Center in St. Paul. So fortunately, I need to give only three lectures. I know first six lectures were given by these two American teachers. I think it's a kind of a good idea to invite American teachers and talk about Shobo Genzo. Shobo Genzo is difficult, and what I'm doing during Genzo is it's really difficult to understand Shobo Genzo only by reading translation. In the translation, many things is lost, and some things is twisted, and other things are added. So it's really difficult to understand what really Dogen wanted to say. So what I have been doing during Genzo is to kind of as my offerings as a person who was born and educated, studied Buddhism, especially Dogen's teaching in Japan, offer my understanding of what Dogen meant from my study and practice of Dogen's Zazen. But I think it's kind of difficult to expect more Japanese teacher coming to this country and give teachings. So in the future, we need American teachers who can talk, study and talk, give lectures on Shobo Genzo. So I hope Genzo continues even somehow when I disappeared. That is my wish. Anyway, I don't have much time today, so let me read this Dharma discourse, because this Dharma discourse is interesting to me, because what he's saying here is basically the same with what Dogen said in Shobo Genzo, Gyōbutsu Igi, that is what the first school we are going to study in May. And Gyōbutsu Igi. And Butsu is of course Buddha, and E is dignity or dignified, and Gi is I translate conduct, some kind of forms we do things, we use this body. So there are some shape or forms, and it is said, whatever Buddha did, there is a dignity. So dignified conduct means Buddha's activity. And usually this expression is interpreted as practice Buddha's dignified conduct. So the way things are done in the monastic practice are a kind of dignified conduct came from Shakyamuni Buddha. And monks practice what Buddha did. That is the original Chinese meaning of this expression. But as usual, Dogen changed the way of reading this phrase. Instead of practice Buddha's dignified conduct, he cut this phrase in here and interpret this Gyō Butsu as Buddha's name. There is a Buddha whose name was practice Gyō. So he read this as a dignified conduct of practice Buddha, the Buddha whose name is practice. That means practice is Buddha. You know, there are a concept of three Dharma body, Buddha body, Buddha Bushin, Buddha's body, Dharmakaya, Nirmanakaya and Sambhogakaya. No, the order is different. Dharmakaya is the way things are, is Buddha's Dharmakaya. The truth or reality is Buddha's Dharmakaya. And Sambhogakaya means, Buddha has been practiced for many lifetimes. As a result or reward of his past practice, the person became a Buddha. That is called Sambhogakaya. Right? And Nirmanakaya is Shakyamuni after he was born and he became Buddha. And this Shakyamuni has a human body and mind, and it is said this is Nirmanakaya, means Nirmanakaya means what is Nirmanakaya in English? Manifesting. That is, Dharmakaya has no forms, but Shakyamuni as a human beings has forms. So this is formless Dharmakaya appeared in this world with a human form. That is what Nirmanakaya means. But when Dogen did this expression as practice Buddha, I think he's kind of making another body of Buddha, that is practice Kaya. Our practice is Buddha. It's, you know, even though we practice, we are human beings, and we are still deluded, full of delusion or self-centeredness. But when we wholeheartedly, you know, practice zazen or other things, even though we are still self-centered, this our practice is Buddha. That is, I think, basic meaning of what Dogen is talking about. Even though we are still deluded human beings, if we have a genuine faith and practice wholeheartedly, that practice is Buddha. Without this kind of Buddha, you know, all those three Dharma, Buddha Kaya, Buddha's body, are kind of a concept. And Nirvana Kaya Buddha is done, is gone, it's dead. Even now, you know, what Buddha taught is available as a Buddhist scriptures. But Buddha's awakening and Buddha's activity is already in the past. So it's not a real thing. Only way, you know, Buddha's awakening and Buddha's practice and Buddha's teaching can be manifested, can be existing at this time, at this exact moment, is through our faith and understanding, studying and practice. So actually our practice is only real Buddha. I think that is basically what Dogen is discussing in Gyokutsu. So on that basis, Buddha's birthday has different meaning, different from our common understanding. You know, Buddha was born in India, actually in Nepal, 2500 years ago. And we celebrate for his birthday. And of course, that is the meaning of this celebration. But from this idea of Dogen, we can understand the same activity we are going to do in a kind of a different, with different meaning. So let me read this discourse. Today, my original teacher Shakyamuni Tathagata descended to be born at Lumbini Park. Lumbini is the name of the park he was born. Every year on this day, we always have Lumbini Park. Tell me whether the great sage is born or not. So he used the present tense, that means is Buddha born? Not in the 2500 years ago, but today, now, this moment. If you say he has descended to be born, I grant you have done one portion of practice. If you say he has not descended to be born, I grant you have done one portion of practice. If you are already like this, you are not obstructed by mountains or oceans and will be born to a king's palace like Shakyamuni Buddha. if you are not obstructed by mountains or oceans? Are you obstructed by birth or not? Even if previous Buddhas and ancestors say that they are obstructed by birth, today this mountain monk, Dogen, simply says that I am not obstructed by birth. If we are not obstructed by mountains or oceans and are not obstructed by birth, all people in the entire earth and the entire universe are born together with Shakyamuni Tathagata and say, above the heavens and below the heavens, I alone am the world honored one. After taking 7 steps in the 10 directions, this statement was the lion's roar and a baby's crying. How do you express such a manifestation? After a pause, Dogen said, in the entire universe and pervading the heavens, good fortune arrives. The grandmotherly intimate heart is expressed by the sages descend to birth. How can we make offerings, serve, make prostrations, and bathe to celebrate the sages' descent to birth? Together with the pure great ocean assembly, let us enter the Buddha hall and perform the ceremony. So he said, every year Lumbini Park is here. Here means where we are in this case, in this Zendo. This is Lumbini Park. And we should make sure if Shakyamuni is born this morning. And what is the birth of Shakyamuni? I think is when we practice as a Buddha, or when we practice Buddha, the Gyobutsu is born at the moment. So we are, our practice is the parent of Buddha. And so our practice is newborn Buddha. This is very interesting idea, I think. So today my original teacher Shakyamuni Tathagata descended to be born at Lumbini Park. He was born today, at this moment. If we practice sincerely and wholeheartedly, our practice is the Buddha. Every year on this day, we always have Lumbini Park. Only this day, that is April 8th, but any day here and now. Tell me whether the great sage is born or not. So he's asking, is the Buddha born through your practice? If our understanding and practice is an expression of what Buddha taught, then we give birth to the Buddha. But often, even though we do things same as a form in the same way, but the thing we express using our body, speech, and thought can be self-centeredness. in that case, our practice is not express the Buddha. So Buddha is not born. So we need to practice. Practice means doing things in a way we can express Buddha's teaching. That means when we do things following Buddha's teaching, our activity express Buddha's teaching. That is how Shakyamuni is born. That means Shakyamuni Buddha, Buddha's life is new and fresh each moment. Dogen says something strange or interesting, and if we understand, we don't understand Dogen's logic, we don't understand what he's talking about. That is obstruction. So he is asking, if you say is Buddha is born through our activity or not, then he said, if you say he has descended to be born, descended means before he was born on this world in India, he stayed in the Tushita heaven, so it's above. So when he was born, he descended from the heaven to the earth. So if you say he has descended to be born, I grant you have done one portion of practice. So if we say yes, you know, through our activities or practice, Buddha is born here and now. Then Dogen said, I recognize, accept that you are practicing Buddha's, what Buddha taught. But next he said, if you say he has not descended to be born, I grant you have done one portion of practice. So even if you say no, then still he accepted that your practice expressed Buddha. This is Dogen's logic. That means, so in the second sentence, if his student or monks said Shakyamuni was not born, this does not mean the monks who say such a thing is expressing his egocentredness, but this means when we think, if we practice sincerely following Buddha's teaching, Buddha is born, newborn Buddha is born here and now. That is one understanding, one thinking. But when we really practice, we should just practice. If we practice and thinking, this is the way we give birth to the Buddha, then that is thinking. That is not a real thing. In that case, when we say Buddha is born, then Buddha is not born. When we just do it without thinking Buddha is born, then actually Buddha is born. You know, this is a strange logic, but it's important, very important to understand this logic. He used the same logic with understanding too. You know, not understanding usually means lack of understanding. So lack of understanding is not a right thing. So we have to understand. But to understand is not enough. At least in Buddhist practice, we have to forget the understanding and just do it. Simply do it wholeheartedly without thinking that I'm doing this because this is what Buddha taught, and this is how I became a good student Buddha. If we are thinking, then that thinking is something extra. When we do, just do. And we within this just doing, Buddha is born. But when we are thinking, Buddha is not born. That is the difference between idea or thinking and practice, actually doing. That is what gyo means. To explain, you know, this second meaning of not understanding, I often use example of learning how to drive a car. When, you know, I didn't drive a car until I was 28. While I lived in Massachusetts, when I lived in Japan, it's not necessary to drive a car. We can go anywhere by public transportations, by bus or trains. So I was not interested in driving a car at all. But when I lived in the Western Massachusetts, I couldn't even do shopping without driving a car. So I tried to get a license. So until then, I know nothing about the car and how to drive it. So first thing I had to do is learning how each and every part of the car and how does it work. So first I have to memorize the parts of the car. Then I had to study the traffic regulations and memorize them. And I actually started to practice driving a car. I learned for a while, and I got a license, and I could drive a car. But after I got the license, I could drive a car, but I had to think. You know, what the road sign means, and when we drive on the like a hilly places, uphill and downhill, we have to change. I didn't have an automatic car, so I had to change the gear. And so I have to think, how steep the hill is. I have to think this should be second or third or things. And I have to remember what the signs means. That is the thinking. And I do driving, following the thinking. But after for a while, when I become used to driving a car, I can do without thinking. Without thinking, I know what I should do. That is in kind of a traditional Zen expression, when a person is riding a horse in a very skillful way, we say there's no horse underneath the person, and there's no person above on the horse. Horse and the person are really one thing. And if drivers are skillful enough, the car and the driving person and the road and things happening around the car is one thing. And without thinking, if we are mindful, that means if we are not sleepy or if we are indulge in some kind of thinking, we can drive safely without thinking. That is what Dogen say, not knowing. Not knowing Dharma means we can practice Dharma, or our body and mind can express Dharma without thinking Dharma should be this or that. So when he said, if you say he has not descended to be born, I grant you have done one portion of practice, means you are kind of a mature practitioner. So you don't need to think Buddha is born. But actually, in actual practice, Buddha is actually born. That is, this is what really means by his expression of just do it, or shikantada, just sitting. So when we sit, we just sit. You know, somewhere Dogen said, this zazen, this sitting, actually sitting using this body and mind is Buddha Dharma. And Buddha Dharma is only this sitting. But he didn't stop from there. But he said, Buddha Dharma is just Buddha Dharma, and sitting is only sitting. That means if we are sitting and thinking this is Buddha Dharma, then this is not Buddha Dharma. This is thinking. But when we really just sit without thinking, sitting is Buddha Dharma. You know, this sitting, just sitting is Buddha Dharma. That is his kind of unique logic. Then, if you are already like this, you are not obstructed by mountains or oceans and will be born to a king's palace like Shakyamuni Buddha. This word obstructed is a translation of gay. And this is the same gay in K-ge. We chant the Heart Sutra every morning, and this word K-ge is appeared in the Heart Sutra. Shin mu K-ge mu K-ge ko mu uku fu. And in our translation, K-ge is translated hindered. So this original meaning of this K-ge is hindrance. That's why I translated as obstructed. But again, Dogen used this expression K-ge in a very unique way. So originally K-ge is a negative word. And mu K-ge, no hindrance, is a good thing. He used instead of mu, but he used hu. Not to be obstructed. And he used this word kege in a both sometimes negative way, as same way in the Heart Sutra, it is hindrance. But he used this same expression in a positive way too. That means in this K is like a net to catch a bird, or net catch a bird or a fish or animals. Then you know, the hunter, for example, put the net on a kind of animal, then this person, this living beings, cannot move freely. So for this, this is a hindrance. And this is the original meaning of kege, like in the Heart Sutra. Because of this disturb or prevent us going freely. That is the original meaning. But Dogen used this the same thing as a positive meaning. That means when these living beings and this net become one, 100% hindrance obstructed means this animals and this net become one. For example, when I was ordained and became a priest, I had to put this kind of robes and okesa. One American priest said, you know, when she was newly ordained, she felt like she is wearing a sleeping bag. It's really difficult, so this became an obstruction or hindrance. But when we get used to wearing this and doing things, and how to use our body, when this person and these robes become one, actually, this is not hindrance anymore, but it's still there. when Dogen used this word keige in a positive way, that means when this person and these robes become really one, these robes become a protection for this person. Now, when I put this robe, I cannot do certain things. I can do, and these robes are designed to the Buddhist things. It's not convenient to the other things. So when I wanted to do other things, this is really obstruction. This disturbs me. But when we do Buddhist things, this is a protection. That is how Dogen used this keige means. And he used this ge in the positive meaning in Fukanza Zengi. In my translation of Fukanza Zengi, what Dogen said in not the Japanese, in Chinese, is Yui Mu Za Zen. He Ge Gochi. Yui means only, and mu is tsutomeru, that means to make effort, and to do zazen. So that means Buddhas and ancestors only practice zazen. And he makes this verb passive. And ge is this obstruction. And gochi is, gochi means immovable. So gochi means immovable sitting. So this second part literally means those people are obstructed by immovable sitting. But of course, obstruct doesn't work, doesn't convey the meaning. So I translated this as they were protected by zazen. But actually, the word Dogen used is being obstructed. If we practice zazen, somehow zazen obstruct us and prevent us to do certain things. And I think this is a kind of a strange rhetoric for people who are not familiar with Dogen. But Dogen used this word keige often in Shobokenzo, in both meaning, without saying, now I use this in this way or that way. So it is really confusing to me.
Is that the term keige, would that be the equivalent of klesha originally?
Klesha means delusion or delusive desires.
Yeah, or it's often translated, I think, as obstructions or hindrances.
Yeah, yes. So, Fene, that is a logic or a rhetoric we have to understand several sentences after this, in this Dharma discourse. So, if you are not obstructed by mountains or oceans, are you obstructed by birth or not? And I have to say one more thing. Somewhere he said, keige or being obstructed and being not obstructed are the same thing. That means if we are obstructed by Zazen or by Buddhist laws completely, we become free. So when we are completely obstructed, we are completely free. Free from obstruction. So there's no, when we become one with that thing, in this case, that thing is Dharma, or practice of Dharma. When we have desire or desire to do something else, this is really hindrance. I cannot move, or I cannot do something I want. It's really a hindrance. But when my desire or wish or aspiration become one with Dharma, you know, this Dharma is protection. Does this make sense? That's a problem of Dogen, or problem of our problem when we study Dogen. So not obstructed by mountains or oceans can mean the person and the world is one thing. Then we are born, like Shakyamuni was born in his father's palace. We are born in the palace. And where we are born is the palace. Even if previous Buddhas and ancestors say that they are obstructed by birth, today this mountain monk Dogen simply says that I am not obstructed by birth. You know, birth and death is actually life and death. Shoji actually means the translation of Sanskrit word samsara, the continuation of transmigrating within six realms is called life and death. So when we have to be born within the six realms of samsara, then we are obstructed by our desires or three poisons mind. That's why we have to be born in this cycle of suffering. But for a bodhisattva who is born within this samsara as a part of vow, bodhisattva vow, in order to, you know, beings and numbers, we vow to save them. That means in order to help them, we have to be within samsara. Otherwise, there's no way to help them. So, bodhisattva is born within samsara as the practice of their vow. So being life and death is not something we want to avoid, and yet we cannot avoid. If we think I don't want to be here, but I have to be here, then that is hindrance of obstructions. But this is my place, this is my father's palace, this is where I need to live, to practice as Bodhisattva. Then this place is where we wish to be. Then life and death is not a hindrance or obstruction. Of course, there are many difficulties, or we still have many delusions and passions or desires that is against Dharma. Still, if we think we are sure this is where I need to do, I need to practice, I need to be, then with the same logic, this is a practice, this is a place we need to be, then this place and this person is one thing. Then it's still obstructed, but this obstructed is a kind of a gift for a Bodhisattva to have a chance to work with other people. If we are outside of this samsara, there's no possibility to work with people. So if we are not obstructed by mountains or oceans and are not obstructed by birth, that means we really determined this is my place to practice, even though there are so many difficulties, pains and sadness. Then all people in the entire earth, all people in the entire earth, and the entire universe are born together with Shakyamuni Tathagata. So all beings within this samsara, or in this world, is born together with Shakyamuni. And say, above the heavens and below the heavens, above the heavens and on the earth, I alone am the world honored one. So this means only this baby, newborn baby Shakyamuni, but all beings, all people are saying, I alone am the world honored one. Everyone says, I am the one, world honored one. So Buddha is not only this newborn baby, but all people in this world, in this universe, are saying, I am alone the world honored one. So after taking 7 steps in the 10 directions, this statement was the lion's roar. Lion's roar is Buddha's teaching of Dharma, the strongest teaching. And Dogen says, this is the lion's roar and the baby's crying. You know, probably when he was born, he was just crying. Babies cry. And each and every baby is saying, I alone am the world honored one. So not only Shakyamuni, but when we are born, we are the same. So how do you express such a manifestation? Such a manifestation means oneness of our birth and death, that is our life, and this entire world or universe are one, even though this is samsara. And yet we vow to live within this place together with all beings. Then this place is not a place I wish to leave, I wish to escape. So we intentionally being here and now. Then the person and the activity as a practice and the world is one thing. This oneness of being and all person and all beings and time and space. That is what Dogen says in Shobogenzo Uji. Beings and time and space and person are one thing. Well, I'm sorry, it's already 10:11:10. So let me just read a final comment by Dogen. In the entire universe and pervading the heavens, good fortune arrives. This is a good fortune. That means each and every moment, here and now. And the grandmotherly intimate heart, this is compassion, is expressed by the sages descending to birth, not only Shakyamuni, but all bodhisattvas. How can we make offerings, serve, make prostrations, and bathe to celebrate the sages' descent to birth? Together with the pure great ocean assembly, that means his monks together, practicing together with Dogen. And finally he said, let us enter the Buddha hall. So this discourse is given in the Dharma hall. And now after this Dharma discourse, they go to the Buddha hall and do the ceremony for celebrating Buddha's birth. So let us enter the Buddha hall and perform the ceremony. So this is what we are going to do. So this is the way Dogen understands Buddha's birthday, Buddha's birth, and our practice. So Buddha's birth is not something happened only once in the history, in a certain place, in India or Nepal. But here and now, when we are practice, study and practice sincerely, following Buddha's teaching, Buddha is there. And so, our practice is newborn Buddha. And we, at the same time, we are the parents of Buddha. Well, this is what I have to say. Are there any comments or question? Please.
I found it interesting when you talked about the net or mm-hmm. Saying that, you know, when the being becomes one with it, mm-hmm. It's sort of liberation. Mm-hmm. That sounds very much like saying, you know, if we're completely at one with samsara, then mm-hmm. that's nirvana.
Yeah. And, you know, if, you know, we have a certain karma, and often we don't like this. But when we accept this body and mind, these five skandhas, as me, and really become one, that means we need to take care of this. And yet we have to find or create the way how these five skandhas can be in a most healthy and harmonious way. Then, you know, this karmic body and mind is only things we can use. When we use the word use, then that this person and these five skandhas are two separate things, but actually, you know, we, besides these five scans, there's no I. So this oneness of all being as one, and we accept this karma then this karma can really be me and start to, and we can be creative to how to use this body and mind to live together with all beings in a harmonious, healthy way.
It reminds me also of a comment I remember reading by Francis Dojun Cook.
Mm-hmm.
He said, it's not liberation from karma, it's liberation mm-hmm. to karma. I always yeah. found that very interesting.
Mm-hmm.
It's not that we somehow get out of our karma, we actually liberate into our karma.
Yeah, we need to learn how to use this. Yeah. Okay. Okay, thank you very much. So now we have a ceremony for celebrating Buddha's birthday, and after that we have potluck lunch, so if you can, please stay.